My name is Terry Orr. I've been up here for 26 years, and I'm an orthopedic surgeon in the Barton Hospital. Alan and Caroline Brockovich are physical therapists at Barton, and they're going to be giving you all the real information that's on keeping fit and exercising to get yourself ready for the season. We've been talking about just the who, what, where, when, why of what we're winter sport injuries, and then brief anatomy review. When you look at things on how do you recognize injuries, I get the question often, do I need to come in? What should we be looking at? And it's especially relevant for you out there that have kids that are running around because they get banged up all the time. And, you know, I've gone through a few of those with my kids, and so my knee hurts, my ankle hurts. It's like, okay, fine, we'll live. They're okay, but what are the things you look for that make a difference? And then we'll get into some things, just a general overview of different things with treatment for knee injuries, winter sports injuries, and then we'll get into prevention. So, excuse me, we don't have a clicker here, and I hope I get these things going right. So, just to, you know, highlight the how big of a problem we're looking at. There are some 70,000 ACL injuries that happen in skiing each year. Just on average, we look at a term of injuries per skier day, and roughly there's one injury per 1,000 skier days that happens to the knee, and 1/3 of those are ACL injuries. So if you have 1,000 people skiing, the odds are one person's going to get injured, and out of 3,000 people, there'll be one of those is going to be an ACL injury. It's a lot more common in skiing than snowboarding, so there's snowboarders out there give yourself a hand. But on the other hand, 40% of snowboard injuries are wrist injuries, upper extremity injuries are high as well. Much more common in snowboarding. ACL injuries are more common in women skiing versus men, so it's a bit of what's irrelevant. This is Darren Rawls during a race in a place called Alta Vida. And the best thing about this is, you see in a minute, he gets up and walks away from it. And so there are things that you can do that defy all logic on, are you going to get injured or not? But if you're in a course that's prepared and there's safety netting and they blow a thousand pounds for you to run into it, it makes a world of difference for the walking away. Unfortunately, we don't have it every place that we go ski. So there's kind of a recurring theme that I hear over and over in the office when somebody comes with, you know, with an injury, and they'll say, one of the more common things is my binding didn't release. And it just highlights the importance of having your equipment ready for the season and getting checked out, making sure that bindings do release. This gentleman, this is during a World Cup downhill, and he didn't see it in real-time motion. You get to watch it again in slow motion. But these guys turn up their bindings so the din setting is hard, the tension of the binding. You know, mine runs at about 6 or 7. Aggressive skiers maybe up to 10 or 12. His is about 24. And it's like being bolted into your ski. His binding didn't release. Ski didn't release. And he does a 360 on his leg. He ended up with an amputation of his lower leg because of the amount of soft tissue damage that was done. Being aware of... get these things going as we come along here, but knowing where you are, if you're in the park, you should have a physics minor, if not a physics major, to know what the speeds are for the jump and where to land and the like. And one of the more common things for skiers and snowboarders is overshooting the jump or undershooting landing on the crest or the knuckle. And taking a landing flat instead of getting absorption of the slope of the hill that comes down. Conditions play a big part of it. One of our busiest months as far as knee injuries is in April. And the reason is that conditions just vary throughout the run from top and bottom. You have icy conditions at the bottom, you have slush at the bottom. Or ice at the top, slush at the bottom on the side of the hill can be very well made. It leads to catching an edge and having the ski take off, and that's what happened to our racer here. If you look at the numbers down below, he's going about 75 miles an hour. When he just catches an edge, goes into a panel, and ends up dislocating his knee. You see him sitting on the side holding his knee, but he also fractured his neck. There's sort of a spine fracture that we call it a distracted injury. You're so focused on one thing. It's one of the things that we teach all our doctors that are involved with ski team coverage is you have to examine everything head to toe to make sure that you aren't missing something, that the obvious is not taken away from something else that may be going on. He ended up having surgery on both areas, but that was pretty much the end of his racing career. Collisions happen, and depending on your bias, it's either I got run into probably into by a snowboarder, or got run into by a skier. It happens both directions, unfortunately. And we have situations where I was just taking a nice run down, I'm skiing the fall line, and all of a sudden this guy gets in my way. And this is during a World Cup race. And this official, for whatever reason, decides he's going to cross the hill, is not check conditions above, and thinks he's got right away. So he goes right in front of this racer. That's kind of the reaction to that, which actually this had not a bad ending. But on the other hand, these things can be somewhat catastrophic when it happens. There's a little music here. But the scout came over, jumped, and not expecting to see anybody. She actually came out not too bad, just an ankle fracture. He ended up with a pretty significant head injury. And it stresses some of the other things of knowing the terrain, knowing where things are, but also we'll get into briefly into the skier responsibility code. Part of it is you don't stop in areas where you can't be seen from above. One of my favorite comments that I get is, it was the last word of the day. It's like, for now. I wouldn't skier anymore with that injury either. So So how do we solve some of these things? And as I talked about earlier, equipment is the one thing you should be looking at. It's the easiest thing to do is get your equipment in, have it tuned, get your bindings properly set, and make sure things are tuned up for the conditions that you're going to be in. If you're going to be on hardtack, you need an edge. If you're going to be in the trees and powders, you really don't want to have skinny skis on those areas. So you have the proper equipment, make, have it ready. ACL awareness, by the way, this binding that's seen here is termed ACL binding. They're marketing it as a binding that prevents all ACL injuries, which the problem is the upward toe release just doesn't happen. So when people get in the back seat and the pressure's going to the toe, it traditionally is a bad release system. But if you're looking for a binding that may give you some advantage, that's the one. ACL awareness looks at the way that people fall when they get an injury, and it goes back to a group out of Vermont Safety Research Group that studied videos of people that fell and looked at common denominators on why did things happen, why did these people tear their ACL. And the things that they found were in common with the people that got injured is they tried to get up while they're still moving, and they're crashing. It's like, oh boy, I'm just going to get up and ski on. It's a bad idea because you're down low, your hips are low, and there's a lot of pressure that when you engage and ski, you know, things are going to go. They're off balance, they're trying to recover, they're getting in the back seat, they're trying to pull themselves up. The other thing is if they also go to sit down and put their hips below the level of their knee, it sets things up. Technically, it's basically like being in the back seat when you're skiing. So your arm is back, you're off balance to the rear, and what happens is the weight gets to the inside edge of your uphill ski, and it starts to carve, and the pressures go to your knee, just take your ACL off in an instant. So they came up with things that they recommended to try to incorporate into your skiing and the way you ski, the way you fall, to make sure it doesn't happen. If you watch this, this is Herman Meyer, and he does everything perfectly. His hands are forward, his weight's forward. Don't straighten your legs when you fall, and don't try to get up. So he just rode it out for about 100 yards, and he came back 2 days later and won a gold medal in Super G in the Olympics in Nagano. It helps to be an Austrian. Any Austrians? Their thigh size is about as big as my chest, and these guys just don't get hurt by and large like the skinny leg Americans, which isn't true, I guess, but they're the equivalent of our football players. They're playing football, they're on the ski. So again, it's proper technique and staying aggressive centered over your skis, and if you fall, don't try to bounce back up, just ride it out. Don't bend your legs up because you don't want to get your hips below your knees. The skier responsibility code, put this up because you've seen it 100 times, you've never read it. You probably won't read it tonight either, but it's basically how you know where you're skiing and how you respect other people on the hill, and it is a key factor. You don't want to be responsible for somebody else's injury. Happens all too often. Know where you're skiing. Don't stop in an area where somebody's going to come up at a high speed and all of a sudden run into you. Literally, figuratively. Knowing conditions, knowing the terrain, and again, it's when you get into the. Anybody go in the park frequently besides Sandra? Any park skiers? I mean, it really is. I think they need to have somebody out doing calculations up there and wind velocity and how high you go and what your speed is on takeoff, because you hear it very often that people get beyond the landing and they hit a flat landing instead of a slope. It's the same thing if you're going up the trees, to know what the conditions are, to make sure there's adequate coverage because obstacles happen and trees hurt. That's all I can say on that. And then conditioning. you know, put on your Superman suit, get out there, but the suit probably itself won't do enough, and that's where everyone's gonna give you all the key on that. And that's really what the last run of the day comes into play. It's, you know, not the knucklehead phrase, but it's fatigue plays a role. And you've been out all day, and the last run, just too often is, or getting a point of fatigue, and that's where conditioning comes into play. You're strong, you're ready. And when my wife says it, I'm just gonna stop for the last run. Okay, got that covered. So, you hurt your knee, what do you do? You don't have to go running in every time, but there's certain things that you look at. If it doesn't seem that bad, the basic things that are the rest, ice, compression, elevation. As long as you don't have a head injury, you have inflammatory medication, it's okay. If you bonk your head, you don't want to take anything, it might increase a lot of bleeding time. So aspirin, anti-inflammatories, if you hit your head, don't do it, otherwise it's okay. Light exercise, and it should be pain-free. You can get on the bike stand, give some time for things to settle down, see how things are doing. If things aren't doing better over a couple days, then you should start thinking about getting things checked out. What are the other things that you should be looking for that are kind of warning signs out there? When people talk about hearing or feeling a pop in the knee, a pop is one of the things that happens with a ligament injury. It's like a top rope that, you know, pops and they, you can hear it, feel it, goes right through your bones to your ears. It's one of the things that it can be bad. It can be your ACL, anterior cruciate ligament, which is when people talk about going out the knee, that's the one they're talking about. Or medial collateral ligament, that's something that can heal on its own and may have the same type of presentation if you're feeling a pop. Swelling is a general barometer of the degree of injury. So if we've got a swollen knee, a tight knee, there's fluid buildup inside the knee joint. That's one of the things I'm looking at to try and assess what's going on. It's a general barometer of injury within the knee and the severity. Typically, if it happens acutely after an injury, it indicates bleeding inside the joint. Instability, loss of strength, you worry about ligament damage or muscle injury. Pain with weight bearing is another factor that you shouldn't be hobbling around in. I'll show you a picture here in a minute of a guy that broke his tibia and walked around railies, walked around for a couple of days because he knew that his ACL, that it was a fracture that needed to be fixed. So there are things that happen in just a general guideline. Loss of motion can be from swelling itself can cause stiffness and loss of motion, but it can also be a torn meniscus or a loose body, something blocking movement inside the knee joint, and something that, you know, demands more immediate attention. Catching and locking similar to something getting stuck in the knee joint for lack of motion. And then if it's something, it follows okay, but it's pain's getting worse or just not improving over the course of 2 to 4 days, time to get it checked out. So we talk about treatment, we talk about the different things, you know, anatomically they get injured. For bone injuries, a fracture is the description for the injury. For the joint surface, it's an articular cartilage that can get injured. The menisci, or the fibrocartilage ribs that sit between the bones, we make every effort to repair when we can. For ligament injuries, we refer to as sprains, muscle tendon injuries, as strains. So just some of the basics on that. Just then going through the anatomy that we look at, turn this on one. So on the left side is just, if you see there it is. Okay, so this is what we're looking at anatomically inside the joints. This is the front of the knee. This is the patella up top here. And this is the femur here. The front part of the femur here, we call the femoral trochlea. It's a little bit of a grooved area. The patella flies back and forth in that area. Coming down into the knee, this is a right knee, and this is the medial joint. So this is the femur again here, tibia down below, and this structure right here is the medial meniscus, and that's the area right here that we can see. So the meniscus It helps to transfer the pressure from the femur to the tibia. It spreads it out over a wider area so the pounds per square inch are diminished, less stress going across the joint. That's when going, the stuff we put in the probe, the tip of this probe is about 5 millimeters in length, so a little bit less than a quarter of an inch. Just to give you an idea of the magnification bone. That's the ACL, intracruciate ligament. It has a synovial membrane that covers it. And behind that, to the right, was the posterior cruciate ligament. Now we go over to the lateral side. We're looking over here now. This is the femur. This is the ACL right here. Lateral femoral condyle right here. Lateral meniscus and the tibia right down here. And this is here. The medial meniscus is more fixed and rigid than the lateral meniscus. And so when the tibia shifts, there's a lot of pressure that goes onto the meniscus and that will cause tearing of the meniscus. Because of the pressures that are transferred from the femur to the tibia spread out by the meniscus, it's the importance of the role of the meniscus itself and why we make efforts to repair instead of remove. I started my orthopedic training back in 1980, and that was kind of, arthroscopy was not all over the place. Most of the guys that are the attendants where I trained didn't do it. As the first year resident, one of the things we did, we prepped the leg, scrubbed it, went out to the scrub seat, the attendant went in, put his kind of gloves on, and would be scrubbing away, and we'd look in, the attendant might come out the window, holding up the meniscus, and say, hey, look what I got, I'm looking out already, 5 minutes. Another case. So things have changed a bit. We've learned to scaffold later, turn these things out, but again, repair is the standard that we're looking for. Fractures, again, this is the gentleman I talked about. Injured his knee, he and his buddies said it's an ACL injury, you're fine, whatever. And you can see right here, this fracture line right here, and this is actually the surface of the bone. It's crushed down, should be up even with this. So the front part's broken down and separated. So with fractures, you look at, is it within the joint or intra-articular? Does it affect stability? Is it displaced? Displacement in the joint, we don't tolerate because you're left with an unsmooth joint, it's going to be arthritis. Does, in a younger person, does it involve the growth plate? So we refer to this as a metal deficiency. It's what you need is they have metal put in, screws, get that back up in place. And again, going back to, is it something that if you can't put weight on it, we worry about fractures and injuries that can be quite severe. When we talk about meniscus injuries, so when you cut a meniscus into what we call the cross-section view, the meniscus comes out in here, the femur and the tibia is flatter than the femur, so it kind of works as a shim to spread the load out. But this is a meniscus that the blood vessel has been injected with India ink, and what it shows is the vascular pattern only comes out a few millimeters into the body of the meniscus. And that's why when we look at why we can't repair all the meniscus tears. If the tear is back in here, it is close to the blood supply, has a better potential for healing. If it's out in here, there just isn't the potential. The meniscus is white through this area, where you have vascularity, it has a reddish orangish hue to it. So as brilliant as we are, we call this a red-white zone, where red meets white, whatever. It just indicates that that's the, where the vascularity is, and more better chance for healing. So just when we look at these tear patterns, so this is a meniscus, this is the edge, the back part, is there, there's a tear that just splits right into it. And again, so it's in the white area, it's white on white, it's just not gonna heal. Unfortunately, this is the type we take out, with one exception. If you have a young person, 18 or under, they heal like frogs, they'll grow new legs, and you cut it off, they can actually heal these. And we had some that have been torn all the way through, stitched back together, and have healing potential. This is a tear that is in that red area. This is actually in the back of the knee where the femur is here, part of the knee is there, and we're looking in the back where we have this split in the meniscus right there. So that's a great area for healing back in that area. So just briefly, we talked about the different zones, 0123, 0 being out in red, red, white, where 01 need, and we get, further we get away, we just aren't doing the repair. So if it's 3 to 5 millimeters, we, you know, are looking at excision. If it's closer to the rim, we put stitches in like this to bring the 2 inches of the meniscus back together to hold while it heals. Articular cartilage sometimes is defies diagnosis until you get in there, and it's usually worse than you expect. It just, and then cartilage doesn't show up on an x-ray. You see the bone, you don't see the cartilage. And a lot of times it's by suspicion that if you have somebody that they're complaining of catching or locking, they've had an impact injury. You know, the MRI doesn't always give us information. So we go by what the mechanism of injury was. They had a catching, locking. A lot of times our, you know, first thing that we see that really gives a hint, we see a loose body floating around, and it's articular cartilage. You know it came from somewhere, so you keep looking, and you find the hole in the articular cartilage. So this is basically normal cartilage, and a chunk came out of here, and that dark area is down in bare bone. And this is, you know, potentially a big injury left untreated. That hole is going to be fatal over time. So we want to do something to fill in that hole. There are a few different ways we can take care of it. And kind of all through here, which is either stimulating the body to form cartilage, and fortunately it doesn't form what we call hyaline cartilage, a natural cartilage that's over a joint. It'll form more of a fibrocartilage or a scar tissue patch, but it's not a bad substitute. We can take cartilage from one area and transfer it. We can take it from a cadaver donor. And there's another way that's out there where the cartilage from juvenile donors' cadavers, and it has a higher cell viability, and it's a new technique that may be a big way in the future to use that to put it in to get it to grow. This is what we do with an osteochondral allograft. They basically take in a cadaver tissue. This is a fresh graft. This is a little bit thicker blood than try to take a 6 to 8 millimeter thickness instead of a 10 millimeter. We transfer from there into the patient where they've got the spare spot and put it in place to fill that point to get actual hyaline cartilage back into the area. Ligament injuries, ligaments connect bones and control motion so things stay together, stay stable. Anybody know what's wrong with that picture? So this is a person that got caught in an avalanche and dislocated his knee. And we reference the direction of the dislocation by what the more distal, further away from the heart part goes. So this is an anterior dislocation, the tibia dislocated this way. This is what it should look like. And when you do that, you're going to have at least 3 out of 4, if not all 4, major ligaments. So you have the ACL, PCL, anterior, posterior, cruciate ligaments. Medial lateral collateral ligaments, medial being on the inner side, lateral on the outer side of the knee. And if you look at, you know, this, the ACL attaches here and here, and it doesn't stretch like a ligament. So it's gonna go. Four ligaments again. The MCL is one that, in most cases, is treated non-operatively unless it's combined with other injuries and it's grossly lax. Lateral collateral ligament is one that doesn't get injured as often. If you think about football injuries, people getting clipped and hit from the outside of the knee is putting stress to the inner side and bows to the open this way to tear the MCL. LCL injuries on the outer side, it's rare that you get hit from the inside of the knee, but we see it in skiers when they hit trees and the leg wraps around the tree. Trees usually win in that case. And it's one that it's more often that we have to repair or reconstruct. The ligament reconstruct, you can rebuild it with some other tissue. Posterior cruciate ligament goes the other direction from the ACL. So ACL is going this way. This is the PCL. And this is the type of injury we see, again, with collision. Somebody runs into something, see it in car accidents frequently, but also skier versus tree, where the tibia gets hit on the tree, it just drives the lower leg back and injures the PCL. Most PCL injuries are treated non-operatively, but isolated. the body has a big capacity to compensate for the quad strength to protect it, but in the grossly unstable knee or in a multi-ligament injured knee, reconstruction becomes indicated. And then finally, with ACL injuries, this is a normal ACL here, and this is what we call a mount bend tear. There are hundreds of fibers of ligament tissue that are combined to make the ACL, and when it tears it, if it's mid-substance, you look at it, just multiple fibers, you just can't patch it back together. So by and large, these end up being reconstructed if we go the surgical route. And it's something that there's a bit of a bias here. If you put a brace on your knee, you walk to the store, you're going to have 100 people say, I hurt my knee too, and I'll give you all kinds of advice and go through the whole thing, right? But not everybody has to have an ACL reconstruction. The main indication is for an unstable knee. We try to look at the profile of the person in terms of their activity level or demands, what they want to get back to doing, to help them make that decision. We do have hyperactive adults here, and people that are in their 50s, 60s, 70s, and it's important for them to get back to skiing. But there are other options that are out there, and that's part of what Alan's going to talk about tonight, is the whole group that we refer to as COPERS. So one of the options is looking at rehab, rehabilitation, work on strength, consider bracing, and see how it matches into your demands and what activities that you want to do. Repair, when I first got here in 1988, Dr. Steven was still here, and I would say 90% of his ACLs he did repairs on, and when he left here 2.5 years later, 90% were reconstructions. So it was just a transition period where people were looking at how people recover from reconstructions and the success rate versus repairs. The problem with repairs on ACLs is the number of fibers that are torn, and also the environment where it's in a, not in a, where there's a good blood supply. It's in an area where the synovial fluid kind of interferes with the healing. But there has been, there is some work going on now to look at putting the membrane over the ACL, and particularly in young people trying to get recovery for ACL healing by repair instead of doing a reconstruction. When we reconstruct, there are different things that are involved. Timing is one thing, and it's important that when you, if you have an injury, you're opting for the surgical side. We want to make sure that the knee is ready for surgery. We want to be in the best shape possible going in. We want to accelerate the recovery afterwards, and if somebody goes into surgery with a stiff knee, they're going to have a stiffer knee afterwards. So patience is one of the important things. We have to look at what the other injuries are. If somebody has a displaced meniscus that's locked in the knee, then we have to get to that early, and sometimes we'll split the surgery out into two phases. Fix part of it, the meniscus and the other things, and then come back when that's healed and there's enough motion. That becomes part of the prehab process, is getting the knee ready for surgery. In terms of graft selection, there are a lot of different options. It falls into two main categories, autograft versus allograft. And there aren't any hard criteria on this other than there have been some studies showing that for the young athletes, the allografts don't hold up really well. So by and large, if you've got somebody that's young, aggressive in their activities, we're going to stick with their own tissue. The advantage of an allograft, grafting from a cadaver donor, is you don't have to heal the donor site. You have somebody else's issue and they don't care. So you don't have the pain and swelling and soreness from it, so your rehab comes along much faster, gets you back to your normal daily activities quicker. It takes longer to get the release to get back into your sports and the like, but if you're a working person and it's more important to get back to your job than your sports, which is a lot of people, then it becomes a good option. There are different options in terms of what we use, with gelatin, hamstring tendon, quad tendon, and all are good options that you talk to your doctor about, what they have the best success with. There are a lot of all are good ways to go. Allograft, you will use patella tendon or soft tissue grafts, which can be any of the above. So, again, they're all designed to get you same place. And probably the more important, you know, factor in the surgery is how you do it, where you place the graft. So what is limited stress over the last several years is getting an anatomical reconstruction, putting up where the ACL normally is. And then there's talk about single bone, the level bone, which we're not going to get into tonight. But it's basically the ACL has different components to it, and it's one of the areas that's still kind of out there in discussion on orthopedic plan and which way you do. And then by and large, people will favor the single bone group, and the double bone group is kind of limited now. So, anyway, if all things that there's a lot of information on the internet, a lot of information available in the Bailey's checkout line. So be prepared to go and talk to a doctor and make sure that you ask questions about, you know, what's the right thing for you. Alan's going to come up and talk now on the sides of rehab, what happens after you've completed the physical therapy thing, how do we get you back into your sport and get ready. Recovery from injury is similar to what you're looking at now when you're getting ready to ski. If you're getting ready to go back into sport coming off the injury, you need to be strong, you need to be ready. That's why we'll do what we call functional testing, functional assessment, to make sure that a person's strength is regained and they're ready before we allow the people clearance to get back to sport. Is anybody living here doing that weird?
Yeah.
Well, that's coming this year. We're going to be out there. So, anyway, have a safe winter. Thanks again. And I'll turn it over to Alan.
Thank you, Dr. Ward. My name is Alan Barichievick, I'm a physical therapist at Barton, and I'm going to talk about more of the prevention, conditioning, and performance side of the sports injuries. And just some general information is that on average there's about 3 injuries per 1,000 skier days, and that crosses over with snowboarders also. That's just any injury that's reportable pretty much. Skiers obviously primarily are the lower extremities, and as Dr. Ward mentioned, snowboarders are the upper extremities. So what I'd like to talk about without overlapping too much is some cause of knee injuries, some reduction in prevention techniques, awareness, reduction strategies, copers versus non-copers, where we talk about those who have had an ACL rupture and not had it repaired or not had surgery. Bracing, or do we need braces? And then we'll go into more of the prevention and conditioning and exercises, and Caroline will come up and she'll help demonstrate some exercises that we like to use in the clinic and even before ski season to get conditioned, get strong, so hopefully we prevent injuries. So understanding the cause of the injury. I was fortunate enough to speak last week at the Vail Ski and Ride School at Kirkwood. And they had some great data they collected on their employees over the last several years. And the three top reasons they found that employees were getting injured were their physical conditioning, the terrain they were skiing, whether it was over their head or not, or for their technique or skill level, and then also their equipment. So those three things are very important when you talk about causes of injury. So we're going to look at some conditioning, which includes our aerobic fitness, flexibility, fatigue, so overuse syndromes or metabolic fatigue. Once again, we have to take care of ourselves from a nutrition standpoint when we're out there. We need to stay hydrated, we need to eat, because skiing takes energy. And then, have you had a previous injury, and how does that contribute to the potential of injuring yourself again? So, understanding the cause of injury for our skill set. Once again, are you a bump skier? Should you be in the bumps? Steeps, powder, burrs, trees. Like you said, you can't win a battle with the trees. So. And then equipment. And this was really, really important. And I took this when I get to listen to them talking up at Kirkwood, how important really making sure your equipment, one, was tuned up properly before the season started. I mean, a lot of us, we store it away in the garage or in the attic or somewhere, and then we pull it out and go, oh, darn, I didn't get the tuners, I'm going to take it back out without getting it checked. So once again, really important thing about our equipment and what kind of shape it is to make sure our boots, the bindings, our buckles are working and everything is working properly. As Dr. Orr mentioned, that din setting, making sure your din is properly set for your skill set and the type of terrain you ski. Are you a beginner, intermediate, or expert skier? Very important to take into consideration, especially early in the season. You can always change those numbers later as you get more, your body gets more conditioned for the ski season. But you really have to be honest with yourself where you're at the beginning of the season. And no one can get enough ski crash videos, so.
I hurt myself today to see if I still feel. I focus on the pain, the only thing that's real. The needle tears a hole, the old familiar sting. Try to kill it all away, but I remember everything. What have I become? My sweetest friend, everyone I know goes away in the end. And you could have it all, my empire of dirt.
Exercises that we like to focus on are going to be power and stability types of exercises. And when I say landing skills up there, I don't mean 30-foot cliff hucks. I mean actually our ability to control our weight going in one direction and back to the other direction. And then as we develop strength on both legs, we like to emphasize in strengthening on one leg. I'm a big fan of balance and using exercises that always incorporate balance and incorporate the core muscles to strengthen for our functional training. And then if we get better with that, we'll develop conditioning for changing direction. So basically our ability to load one way, stop, control that motion, and go the other direction. This applies to all sports, not just skiing and snowboarding, but really important to think about when you do any sort of sport or activity. And that leads into functional training. One thing we do at the hospital and one of our clinics at the Orson Clinic on 3rd Street is we have a bridge program where we focus on an individual who has had an injury, they've gone through a formal rehabilitation program, and then they're pretty much done with their rehab. They don't really need those types of modalities and treatments anymore, but they want to get back to their sport or get back to skiing. So we have a more functional-based exercise program that will run them through for a few months to then get them ready for a knee test to see where their injured knee now compares to their well knee. And then we'll look at, hey, are you ready to get back on the snow? Are you ready to get more sport performance oriented? So when we think of functional training, it's putting all these things together. So are we really reducing injuries or are we preventing them? Well, the goal is to prevent injuries, but no matter what we do, we can't prevent contact-related injuries. If we run into somebody, it happens. There's an impact, we get injured. But we can reduce the incidence of non-contact injuries. Did anyone see Carson Palmer, Terrence ACL in the NFL last week? Classic non-contact injury. He went, he pivoted, he stopped, his ACL went.